Welcome back to the channel, everybody. This is the reference image we will be using for our painting today. Now let's jump into the sketching process. I've included the entire sketching process at double the speed. You can still get the general idea if you just want to get ahead to the painting. It's at the 10 minute 20 second mark. For the sketch, I will mainly start with just the bigger shapes, the horizon line, and then kind of work my way smaller and smaller. I won't do too much detail. Most of my detail will either be in the focal point, anything maybe I have difficulty painting, I might want to be sure to draw a little bit better just to make the painting process slightly, you know, easier for myself. The perspective I will always try to keep in mind no matter what I'm doing. You know, any line I'm putting down, I want to always make sure it's in perspective, because that's just one of the things I find that helps convey, you know, the composition best. These things will probably be my main focal point, will be the tops of these and the people next to it and the little archway, as well as the high contrast areas. You know, I want to make sure they look good as well. But these things I want to be sure I try to keep in perspective, or that will make the entire painting look weird. Now, you will see later on, I do actually mess up the perspective of these very much. In fact, you can even tell in the sketch the perspective is kind of off. But, you know, perspective is a tricky thing, you know. But it's one of the things, you know, I find most important to work on in, you know, your painting process. You know, I'm not very good at drawing or painting people. I've been doing my best to include them more in my pieces. You know, I know they really tend to, you know, make a piece look organic if you can make them look organic, but that's not always the easiest thing. I try to make, when I'm sketching, I try to have, I guess, somewhat of an emphasis on the areas where the shadow and light meet, the high contrast areas. So once I start the painting process, I don't lose track, because I mean, I am horrible at, you know, sometimes keeping track when I'm in the middle of a wash. I may get caught up, I may get overwhelmed with, you know, what's going on, trying to keep it under control and, you know, just paint over a part. I didn't mean to. I'm sure we all do it. So I find it, you know, helpful to sometimes, yes, as you see right here, I'm, you know, doing these little shading lines in there. Sometimes that even looks good when you can see it through the painting at the end, but most of the time you can't, especially when you paint as heavy as I tend to. But yeah, it helps me a lot to kind of identify my shadow points for myself to keep track of while I'm in the painting process. Alrighty, that should do it for the sketch. Now let's move on to our first wash and the painting process. Alrighty, now with this, since there's such a hard line between the top of the buildings and the sky, I'm actually going to flip the entire painting upside down and paint the sky that way, just so it runs down and I can just use gravity with the wash. But normally I mean, if there wasn't such a hard line, I might typically paint the sky into the top of the buildings. You know, it all depends. But yeah, this one has that hard shadow up top, so I just think it'll kind of look cool if I paint it like this. I'm mainly using cerulean blue chromium for the sky. All of the paints I'll be using will be Daniel Smith. So, and then yeah, I just wanted to leave a nice hard edge at the top of the buildings where the sky starts. Now, it doesn't matter if you go over the buildings a little bit because it is so much darker, so we'll be covering that up. And then yeah, just maybe you can see here I'm injecting more paint into the top that's closer to the building that will, you know, that'll add more depth and make it look behind. And then I'm also lifting off some of that paint from the chimney there. Now here we are onto the buildings. For this part, I'll mainly just be painting the light. Try to keep my highlights in mind that I want to keep. I'm using quinacridone gold, Italian burnt sienna, probably some yellow ochre in there. You know, typically I might paint my warm colors first. Obviously, if I'm doing cool shadows, I will, you know, definitely paint the warm tone first and then the cool shadows on top. But, you know, it just depends on the exact look I'm going for. This scene has such a warm look. Even the shadows are kind of warm, but I will still do cooler shadows just for that contrast. And in this building, I do believe I threw some alizarin crimson in because it had this salmon-y look to it. And yeah, just making sure I, you know, paint around these tops of these parasol things. Try to get some dry brushing in just for some texture. I will a lot of times paint around my people, especially their heads. It kind of just, you know, plus a lot of times if the sun's on top, you have that little highlight on the person, but it just kind of helps keep the people looking like people. If not, they just end up looking like blobs. I think these people will just end up looking like blobs anyway. Like I said, I have, you know, not the easiest time painting people. But yeah, just getting some dry brushing in. As you can see, it was mainly, I did throw some cool colors in for the pavement at the bottom just for that contrasty look. But yeah, and I'm trying to add some, because this area is going to be so much darker in the end, so I'm still kind of some warm tones. You know, I trying to something different here with the splatters for me personally. I'm not the best at controlling the paint when I splatter, so I tend to make a mess. But yeah, a lot of these areas, and plus I don't, you know, I'm not too worried about defining this building on the left, because most of my focal point will be this shadow on the ground in front of the little tent and these tent awning areas. already, and here you see me putting in some flesh tones for the figures in the focal point. And here I will just be painting these small shadows on the top of these tent awnings, as well as some shadows underneath of it, just to kind of define them a little bit more, as well as the areas that aren't in direct sunlight. I want to make them not pure white. So I do believe I am using lavender and French ultramarine. Alrighty, then here you can just see me painting in some random colors for the clothing. I might use the reference image to get an idea for the colors to use, but for the most part, I will just try to, you know, use alternating color, not alternating, but different colors, just so you can, you know, see the difference in between each of the figures. As well as, you know, maybe just reuse some colors that I used in the painting. Alrighty, now here you can see me just putting in some of the darker tones or mid-value tones on the building. I will slowly build this up into the heaviest values and tones that I will be using on the painting. I'm just trying to, you know, follow my reference points for my shadows and, you know, just trying to maintain my highlights. Most of the colors I am using for these heavy tones in the building is Carbazole Violet, Italian burnt sienna, neutral tint, and French ultramarine. All Daniel Smith paints. I will paint around these windows just to, so you can continue to see them. I just think it looks a little bit better than painting over it with this dark tone. I should have defined the windows more in the initial wash, maybe put some blue in there, but can't go back and fix that now. So I will just paint around them just so you can still get, you know, the general idea. I think later on in the painting, I will go back in and paint some blue on them just so they're not giant yellow squares in the middle of my building. Here you see me painting some of the darker tones underneath of the market stands, just to kind of push them a little bit more into the foreground. And this is going to be, you know, one of the darkest points because it's going to be next to the brightest point. Now that may not necessarily be like that in the reference image, but I try to, you know, place my darker tones directly next to my brightest tones just for that, you know, complementary contrast look. Okay, and here you can see me going in and painting some defining shapes into those windows. The darker wash around it is still kind of wet, so it will blend in on paper with that. Just kind of, you know, blend into the shadows will make it look good, in my opinion. And then here you can see me doing some dry brushing with the building on the right, since it's, you know, at such a odd angle to the viewer. I'm just going to be doing the main dark defining features of it, you know, just some dry brushing for windows, paint the, you know, the really dark features for these two little awnings that are jutting out of the face of the building, as well as these pipes that come down with it. Alrighty, and here you can see me putting a second wash on the building on the left. The paints I used were Italian burnt sienna and French ultramarine to get this kind of muted warm tone. Yeah, the main thing I'm just focusing on with putting the secondary wash on is just the windows and the bright white awnings in front of it. I don't want to paint over that, and I just want to kind of keep defining the windows that I have on this building. It's not the focal point, so it doesn't need to be super detailed. And here you can see me painting around two figures I decided to add in. You still can't see them very well in the final painting, but I figured it added some variety to this left side of the painting. There will be some darker doorways and windows along with these people, as well as a little A-frame sign that I still don't think you can see in the final piece. here you can see I start painting this plant in the front in the large black pot. As I was painting the figures behind this, I did leave little highlights at the top of the plant that I will just leave unpainted. And then I'm kind of just letting these colors mix on paper. So I'm not the best at painting foliage, so this is kind of, I've been recently doing a splatter technique, but that would have been way too aggressive for this small little colorful spot. So I'm letting a lot of the color mix on paper. Quinacridone or Hansa yellow, maybe, sap green, undersea green, and pyrrolene red, I do believe, are the colors I mainly used for the plant. And then just a mixture of carbazole violet and neutral tint, maybe, for the dark black pot area. Here you can see me completely messing up the bottoms of the marketplace stalls. Yeah, I did a terrible job painting this piece of the tent on all three of them, including this front one. I messed up the perspective. I messed up the areas where the shadows connect to the market stands. But in the end, it still does not look terrible. I mean, you can tell what I'm trying to convey in, you know, my painting. And yeah, it, you know, it doesn't look that bad. I did not include the plant that you see in the reference image. I just wanted to have a larger shadow area there. You know, I just kind of liked the way the shadow looked on the ground. But yeah, here I think you can see me, I'm strengthening the curvature kind of that back building and where it connects to this area in the center where it kind of flattens out, as well as the shadow underneath of this little overhang here and the tunnel shadow, because I feel like it blends in a little bit too much with the front of the building. I will also strengthen the shadow underneath of these awnings in this part, I do believe, and kind of define the area around the people's heads more. There's also another one of these little marketplace stands behind the people that I have yet to paint. I do believe I paint some blue in there in this part of the footage. But yes, this is, I'm more just putting in very dark, strong tones to kind of define some more of the features, add a little bit more depth, you know, paint around the people so I can kind of push them to the front more and just push these areas back. And as I'm painting these dark tones, I will just leave random spots of lighter tones on the top of the market stands to make it look like there's, you know, maybe items or whatnot. I do believe in the reference image, there's actually people back there sitting down to eat, but I wasn't going to include all of those people. I felt like that would have made the scene too busy. I like to move my people around, you know, don't let the reference image tell me exactly where to put them. But, you know, if it can give me a good idea where to do so, I will, you know, take my cues from it. But, yes, and as you can see here, I did not paint the front of this market stand, and that was a mistake. I do go back in and paint it. But these, I feel, shadows at the bottom and the front of the stands are very important to kind of, you know, define the stands from each other. If not, it'll kind of just look like one long block with three different awnings. And here you see me defining that window on that back building. I kind of wanted a larger highlight there. I didn't quite keep it in the beginning washes, so I'm trying to make it look as good as I can by making the shadow underneath of it a little bit heavier, as well as this pipe. And the platform right here under this door. The pipe, I don't exactly paint correctly either. I had a little bit of an overlap in my... I was trying to get it more of like a quick, you know, well-defined brush stroke with a slight dry brush effect, but I didn't quite get what I was going for. It still looks okay. As you can see, I'm smacking my board all around that my painting's attached to, having trouble trying to work around the filming equipment and, you know, paint at the same time. This is something I'm new to, the old aspect of filming the entire painting process. I am enjoying it though, and I do plan on continuing to do it. I would like to be able to put out as more content than I've been doing so far. So hopefully I am able to do that. And then yes, you can see me just defining that chimney in the back. I will define the line that comes down next to that highlight. And here you see me painting in the heaviest tones on the building on the left, as well as defining the figures a little bit more. We'll be right back. the people in the fore or the primary people here on the right, I do like how they look. And now here you can see me going in, strengthening these shadows in front of the little market stands, as well as painting this one that I did not paint in the very front, kind of defining them more, trying to keep a small little sliver of warm tone in between each of the strong shadow tones. And this one, I'm also bringing it into this potted area. When I paint the shadow of this pot, I want to be sure to stop it and bring it up a little bit so I can, you know, suggest that there's a curb right there that the shadow is bending up over. So that's something to keep in mind, as well as the space of light in between the bottom and where the shadow starts. This dry brushing, I was able to keep in the shadows were just from the earlier washes showing through. It's one of, you know, the great things about watercolor and unforgiving things about watercolor is its transparency. And here I'm just putting in some shadows, random shadows for the figures, as well as this little totem thing that is on the sidewalk in the back. I know you can barely see it in the sketch, but I did include it. I know at some point I go in and paint the front of this awning. Alrighty, and here you can just see me putting some more shadows on the main figures, kind of separating them more, maybe putting some shadows underneath where their arms would be so they don't look like they're just big squares standing next to each other with heads, as well as put a little bit of a heavier shadow on that market stand behind them, and just a little bit of dry brushing for the background. I thought it looked a little bit plain back there. Yeah, I don't have many details hinting at a building in the background, but and then here, yes, you can see me going in and painting this closest market stand. And you can see where the shadow line meets the bottom of the stand. I have far too high, my hands in the way right here, but as you can tell, that kind of throws off the perspective. Now, it doesn't make the entire painting look weird, but I mean, if you know what you're looking at, you can really tell that something's off. I mean, honestly, even if you don't know what you're looking at, something just doesn't feel right to you. And I do believe I go in and try to readjust it, but you know, that's only so possible with watercolor.
Thank you. And then here you can see me adding a little bit more details into the background. It was just a little bit too plain. I'll like to put in some electrical wires, you know, going back and forth, depending on the scene. Well, electrical wires, I really do think, make scenes kind of look more urban. A lot of the time, they look really nice with the open space normally above people's heads. You know, it kind of just connects one side of the page to the other. And then here, just strengthening some of these perspective lines and shadow lines that you see on the right in the foreground. Alrighty, I'm just adding a little bit more details to this main building in the center, and that'll about wrap this painting up. A little bit of dry brushing here and there, defining these windows. We will move on to one of the most satisfying parts of a painting, removing the tape. Forgot to sign my signature on this before I removed the tape. But nice cadmium red for this. I don't always do red. Sometimes I will change it up depending on, you know, maybe the color scheme, just the color I'm feeling, I'm getting from the painting, you know. But typically I will do red just because it stands out a lot and just, you know, looks good. Alright, that does it for this video. My apologies for the inconsistent audio quality. I am slowly working on it and surely getting better. Please like and subscribe, comment down below any future video ideas you might like to see, and check me out on Instagram @ShepherdArtwork.